to get here?
Or, depending on your theology, you could have been the biggest piece of shit imaginable and still gotten into heaven as long as you repented and believed in Jesus and shit. First of all, that shark is wandering through the alleys like it belongs there. Second, it's a well-known fact that four different animals from completely different species will absolutely cooperate in order to hunt together. No, I'm not giving you a source on that, just trust me. And third, why do they have to shove Colin in there to get mauled when they already saved the girl? Don't worry guys, I'll hold them off! I'm the only one stopping them from climbing up this wall like a bunch of f***ing geckos! I have several questions about this giant harp-shaped building. Is that some sort of resort? Does heaven have a hotel too? First of all, that's a meme. That's just a meme that somebody thought would be funny to put in the show. Second, it's one thing for glass to go flying everywhere, but how did this guy get his gear shifter stuck in the ceiling? And third, this guy straight up does not deserve to be saved. Not only was there alcohol in his car, but even worse, he was in the middle of creating an anime profile picture for Twitter. This man is not going to heaven. Yeah, those old TVs are definitely known for exploding when getting shot with a single pistol round. The new TV instantly has a satellite connection without being plugged into anything. Hell, Moxie never even plugged in the power cord. Blitz is actually loading gunpowder into this flintlock pistol, which means that we're seeing this gun being used accurately 4 episodes too late. Sudden Betty Boop porn. Sudden Looney Tunes homage. First of all, don't. Second, Blitz either has two copies of this vag poster or there's a little continuity error here. You know you're working for a company with no money when each employee has their own designated disposable cup.
Is that a hell shake?
Hell shake?
Hellquakes don't happen.
Oh, hell quake, like an earthquake. That makes more sense. Why did Blitz say hell shake?
Stop getting hysterical, fatty!
Hey, remember the pilots? Remember how Moxie has panic attacks? Remember when Luna called Moxie fat that one time? Remember the pilots?
Luna.
Jesus, Luna went native for a second there.
How are you and-
Millie went so southern that I actually thought she asked how are you for a second.
Dastardly inventor of all things loopy and loopish!
How does a seemingly mentally sound inventor seeking immortality turn into a crazy guy who exclusively invents all things loopy and loopish within minutes of arriving in hell?
Shut up, dear furry!
Dear furry? No, those are the Alistair fangirls you're looking for. And for the dozens of people who legitimately didn't think that I knew what a B-movie was in my last video, yes, I know that he said dear, not dear, that was the joke.
Not even a shit's length of time in hell?
How long is a shit's length of time exactly? Sudden old movie. They're really leaning into the old-timey stuff for the first few minutes of this episode.
It could have saved all 3 trillionaires!
Haha, rich people bad.
Unfortunately, we neglected to test the machine on the poor, like we usually do.
Okay, now you're pushing it a little. The machine is actually switched to young here, but then it's flipped over to old in the very next shot.
Yeah, that's not really evil. If we do kill him, though, and he ends up down here, you know, you will be stuck with him.
Okay, this conversation really should have been between Loopty and Moxie rather than Loopty and Blitz. Yeah, I know that it's super important for us to get our monthly allowances of Moxie abuse, but you will never convince me that Blitz is the kind of guy who gives a flying f*** about who they kill or why. Either Blitz actually has a conscience and Viv and Brandon could have done a better job of showing us this, or this is the single most out-of-character moment that we've seen in this entire show so far.
That's kinda hot!
Ah, so Moxie is the type of guy that will fall for any psycho killer, not just Millie. Okay, noted.
To your right is the home of famous inventor Lyle Lipton.
And in every other direction is absolutely nothing from Miles and Miles. This has gotta be the lamest tour ever. Who the f*** gets on a tour bus for one stop? Me, my big talking point from the last episode was how people need to stop thinking that these episodes are connected to each other. But here we are watching the IMP running around in disguises immediately after the previous episode where they were called off for not wearing disguises. I mean, I can still stand my ground and say that you don't need to watch the previous episode in order to understand why they're wearing disguises in this one, but this episode still very much gave the overthinking and over-analytical fandom some solid ammo to use against me.
Things like this can happen to famous people all the time.
Which is why most famous people have some sort of security system for their houses. Hell, tons of typical suburban households have security systems, but not the trillionaire?
Goodbye, my one true love.
Haha, nobody ever loved him. Wait a second, who the f*** hired the cherubs to save him then?
My shitty old body can't do anything of value.
Oh no, if only you had access to a de-aging machine that still very much works. 3.2 seconds. 2.8 seconds.
In there and tie it for him.
1.5 seconds. 1 second. Less than 1 second, 1.6 seconds. Alright, here comes your needlessly deep analytical nitpick for this episode. Even though this cutaway gag between these two shots was possibly my favorite joke in the whole episode, it went by a little too fast. The editing really disrupted the flow of this scene.
On behalf of those in heaven, benefited by your amazing technological advances.
F***ing who? You literally established the fact that they were only going to share this technology with the 3 trillionaires who are still alive!
You should continue the process to commit die.
Never make a character physically speak in meme language. I'm sure that everybody in the writing room thought that this line was hilarious when they just read it on the script, but hearing it spoken out loud completely unironically makes me cringe a little bit.
He can help spread his wealth around with the people of the world!
No.
Okay, I can't be bothered to point out every single instance where this episode makes it abundantly clear that nobody in heaven would ever ask the cherubs to save this man, so I'm just going to add 5 more sins and then move on.
Three-colored chainsaws, katanas.
He's classier than that.
Yeah, really, instead of using guns, you should kill him with an electric chair or a lethal injection. You know, something that's humane and completely painless 100% of the time without fail ever. Jesus, this gotta be the darkest joke I've ever written. I love how they literally couldn't bother to animate Millie puking.
You gonna buy that load of shit from a baby and the sheep it fucks?
Okay, props to Vivzy for voicing this character. Not only is she probably my favorite of the 3 cherubs, and not only does she sound right at home alongside seasoned voice actors, but despite the fact that I've listened to this woman talk for hours on end during countless live streams, I had no idea that it was her. First of all, fursuits. And second, why is the IMP even wearing disguises at all? Lyle already saw all three of them. First of all, yes, a bear can definitely turn a wolf into a bloody gory mess with only one swipe. Totally. Second, this chainsaw cuts off both of this guy's arms simply by falling past him one time. And third, yeah, bucks will totally charge straight at a man for absolutely no reason. They definitely wouldn't run away from a person just from breathing too loudly in its vicinity. That's common knowledge. Just ask anybody who hunts them. Cherubs casually destroy property. Santa. Also, depending on what month the store opened, I might be older than ice cream. Craft mine. Ooh, they really gnomed us. Are we going to get f***ing Rickrolled by the end of the season, too? Vivzy thinks that she's slick for adding this girl into the shot for some nice continuity, but she didn't have any injuries after she magically reappeared back into the classroom seconds after being yeeted through the ceiling. Arguably, this should be a sin for the first episode, but I didn't catch it, so I'm adding it here.
I've never been in love before.
But Lyle already said goodbye to his, quote, one true love earlier in the episode.
This place reeks of teenagers.
This one really bothers me. Lyle saying that this place reeks of teenagers is literally the only indication we have that there might be teenagers hanging around this area. We don't see them, nor do we see a single hint of how many there are or how close by they are until the moment we see them all leave. This is the kind of thing that would normally happen in a live-action movie after somebody just forgot to film something and they just kind of did the best they could in the editing room.
And you three are so superior to us just because we want some selfish, greedy, authoritarian...
As hilarious as Moxie's animation is here, the word authoritarian, by almost all definitions, refers to somebody who is in a position of government and has actual power to suppress people. Now, you could argue that Lyle might be rich enough to bribe a few government officials into cracking down anything that he doesn't like, but I don't want to have that conversation today. I've seen countless variations of somebody comedically using a spray bottle on a person like they're misbehaving pets, but this has got to be the most sluggish, low-energy spray bottle scene I've ever seen.
So, how do we make this bad?
The IMP didn't even do anything to make the nature scene bad. They just handed the man some binoculars. I just made this scene better by literally searching for concerned crowd sound effect and then just slapping it onto this moment. And yes, it is a royalty-free stock sound effect. Because seriously, even though there were technically a ton of black silhouettes filling the seats, I want you to look me in the eye and tell me that you didn't think that this opera house was completely empty before the singer died. I'm sorry, but I will never be intimidated by an angel baby who sounds like Toad when he yells. And now for the single most obvious sin in the history of Hell of a Boss that absolutely everybody noticed. How is the singer still singing after she died? You could make a thin argument that the music here is non-diegetic, but come on. If there's one thing in this episode that bothers me a lot more than it probably should, it's the fact that there's absolutely no transition for the music here. I can tell they just did a basic fade in their video editor to try and make one song blend into the next. I have literally done this before when I had no idea how to transition one song into the next. That said, this moment had me grinning like an idiot so much that I'm taking two sins off. Okay, now the seats straight up go from packed to completely empty between shots. The part where the piano actually hits Lyle looks really bad. I'll talk about this more in a second, so don't get the pitchforks out yet, but yeesh. We saw Moxie's tie and Millie's bra come off earlier, and Moxie still isn't wearing his tie, which logically means that Millie still isn't... Oh boy.
Do not use the Lord's name in vain!
He said gosh though, even at a private Christian elementary school, that's a free pass. And I know that from experience. What if you wanted to go to heaven, but the literal creator of the universe said...
No.
Couldn't you have just had Cletus close his eyes when he cried? This looks weird.
It's a shame. All our client wanted was eternal revenge on his business partner. And now the two are forever separated. And now we gotta face the fire of fucking up.
Yeah, sometimes you just can't succeed no matter how hard you try. Sometimes that failure takes the form of a mission that you wanted to do for a client only for the forces of heaven itself to intervene and ruin everything. And other times it's a video that gets age-restricted due to the mature content that the video covers. Even though the original content in question is able to carry on like normal, meanwhile I make an appeal to get the age restriction overturned in order to get a sizable chunk of my ad revenue back, only to have it rejected. Fucking pieces of shit.
We're in good hands, because texts don't make people angry.
Okay, that's a good line. I'll give you one more.
Snooping as usual.
What do two old genius robotic inventors do now that we're in hell?
I can't be the only person who thought that Serpentis was going to show up here, right? This was absolutely the most okay episode of Hell of a Boss yet. To me, this one just kind of came and went. This episode happened. It was an episode. If you ask me, Cherub was a 5 out of 10 episode with a 10 out of 10 climax. And if you think that's harsh, well, I kind of agree. I'll explain a little more in a bit, but those are my genuine thoughts about this episode. But before I get into why I actually think that it being a little unfair, and why I think that reviewing each individual episode is detrimental to the overall show, which sins that it counted actually bothered me? Well, the first major one was, again, that conversation between Loopty and Blitz. I get that this show wanted to touch on something about the IMP's victims that was never addressed before, and I am a sucker for any scene where one voice actor has a conversation with himself by playing both characters, but they really should have swapped Blitz out with Moxie. It just felt wildly out of character for Blitz to appear to be hesitant about killing Lyle. And again, you could argue that maybe Blitz does have a cautious side to him, but then I'd argue back that Viv and Brandon completely and utterly failed to key into the audience that Blitz could ever be anything other than an irresponsible, impulsive man-child. The second one was just one gag going by a little too quickly. This is still a tiny nitpick, but it is something that I would have done differently personally. The third one is that one bit where the opera music just switches to a different track without any transition. Again, this is another nitpick, but it is something that genuinely bugged me. And finally, there are a bunch of other sins that I was kinda serious about, but all of them can be lumped into one main point. This episode was obviously very rushed. There were a lot more shots with lower frame rates than in the last episode, they didn't animate Millie puking, and Cletus's crying also looked a little cheap and awkward. But actually, those are the ones that I can totally overlook. However, I actually was a little bothered by how they didn't animate any teenagers in Lover's Lookout, and how they didn't draw any people in the seats at the opera house, except for the very specific moments where they were actually a direct part of the scene. Again, this episode was obviously rushed. Alright, those are all my thoughts on Helluva Boss Season 1, Episode 4. Honestly, if that's all you came for, you can close this video right now. I am dead serious, I am done talking about this specific episode. But if you like my lengthy rants about things that admittedly aren't really related to the episode at hand very much at all, then let me first go back to my point about this episode being rushed, and make it crystal clear that, contrary to popular belief, saying that something is rushed does not automatically mean this studio is being cheap and greedy. I kinda touched on this when I covered the previous episode already, but I think that more people need to understand this. You can say that an animation is unfinished, but in the professional world, there is no such thing as a finished animation. You can take a single motion, hell, a single frame, and continue to add more and more and more to it and never be satisfied. You can tweak the motion from a single arm until it's perfect, then add some motion to the other arm just because you can, and then tweak that until it's perfect. Spend days on a character's facial expressions until that's perfect. Add in more background elements with perfect animation in order to make the world feel more lived in. And even if you can somehow take a shot and make it so that every single artist on your team can't figure out a single way to improve upon it, you can then start upgrading the style of the show itself, adding in more shading, realistic lighting, extra details, etc., etc. Animation can become an endless black hole of time and resources if you let it. If you are somehow working on an animation project that has no deadlines, then you need to set them for yourself or the project will never be finished. Hell, one of the VFX teams who did the CGI work for Avengers Endgame kept on working on the shot where Tony did the snap, constantly tweaking things and going over it again and again and again, until they finally turned in the finished shot 2 weeks before the movie premiered to audiences. Also, the same VFX house didn't catch this little mistake where the joints in Thanos' Infinity Gauntlet clips into the palm of his hand a little bit. And in the words of one of their visual effects supervisors,
"It just goes to show there's always a little bit more that you could do."
And this is why you need to be kind to animators. I will point out things that seem kind of off, especially if it's something that I actually notice and it pulls me out of the show for a moment, but I always try to remember that in professional animation, the name of the game is good enough, let's move on to the next shot. And the second thing that I want to say real quick is that I'm starting to feel bad about the fact that I'm making lengthy videos that scrutinize every detail of each individual episode of this show. When we actually get our first season of Haspin Hotel, I hope to God that they either drop the whole season at once or release weekly episodes. Because if they do that, then I won't have to make these lengthy rants where I explain my thoughts about each episode in detail. I'd be fine with reviewing a whole entire show. I'd be fine with giving my thoughts on each season of a show. But when you get specific enough to cover each individual episode, especially when each episode is only somewhere between 13 and 17 minutes long, not including the credits, it will always make you feel like you're being more critical of the show than you actually intend to be. For example, when I say that I think this episode is completely and utterly average, it sounds like a scathing review until you consider that even the best cartoons of all time have average episodes. It's no big deal. It just sounds like a big deal when you post an entire video with a spotlight focused on a single episode. But unfortunately, because we're getting roughly one episode a month, this is just the way it has to be for now. So, yeah.
Oh, no. Oh, no.